Hey folks, we're going to be doing another Bible study now, and this video is going to be talking about some shocking things that Jesus said. And what we always find interesting is when people read Scripture for the first time, they're surprised at the nature of Jesus Christ and the things that he taught. And we're going to go through some of the top passages that people find shocking. So here's some shocking things that Jesus Christ said. But we got a free gift for you guys. When you go to shakanow.net, I'm going to show you the website here. Notice www.shakanow.net. Scroll down to the bottom here, and we have a free audio Bible for you. Here it is right here. And then also, you can get free Christian mobile app for your smartphone. And here you can click to see questions and answers about Christianity, science, Jesus Christ, and the foolishness of atheism. So check that out. And don't forget to see this video here of the Atheist Experience Show admitting that it is possible for the resurrection to be true. So we really want to thank the Atheist Experience Show for finally admitting that the resurrection is not impossible, but possible. And I'm going to show you, from my opinion, that it actually really did happen. So let's go through some shocking things that Jesus Christ said. And if you want to see these videos that I just talked to you about and get the free audio Bible, go right here to shakanow.net or click right below this video. It'll take you there. Let's begin. So let's start with Matthew 7:13, and check this out. You know how in our modern times, people will say stupid things like, well, your truth is your truth, and my truth is my truth, and you know, you believe what you want, and I'll believe what I want, and you have your path, I have my path, and as if whatever path we take gets us to where we want to go, right? And it's just foolishness. It doesn't even make logical sense because all these competing worldviews cannot be correct if they're all contradicting each other. So, for example, atheism contradicts Christianity. Islam contradicts Christianity. Hinduism contradicts Christianity. So I think we would all agree it's foolish to say that all these paths can be correct. Let's look what Jesus says on the subject. So go with me, guys, to Matthew 7:13. Jesus said, "Enter by the narrow gate." Now, what he's about to say is actually the complete opposite of what the world would tell us. The world says, no, there's many ways. You know, even Oprah was on TV saying there's many ways to God and all this other stuff. Well, that goes against what Jesus Christ is going to say here, as you'll see. And it's interesting that most people, if they're claiming to be a good person, they'll say they're a good person, etc. They'll say that, yeah, they're going to go to heaven. They're not going to go to hell. You'll talk to atheists, they'll say, no, they're not going to go to hell. You'll talk to Muslims, they'll say they're not going to hell. No one admits that they're going to hell. So it's interesting when you read what it says here in Matthew 13, listen to the shocking words of Jesus Christ. He says, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction." Look at this sentence here. "And there are many who go in by it." So he's saying there's many that are going to take the wide gate that lead to destruction. Because, he says, "narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life." And look at this word, "few." There are few who find it. So we have a problem here if people think that there's all these different paths to heaven and all these different paths to God, and everyone, a lot of people, I would say every person I talk to, they deny that they're going to hell. Atheists will deny they're going to hell. Yet what you have here is Jesus Christ is saying many are going on the wrong path. Notice, he said, wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many who go in by it. There are many who go in by it. And then he talks about the way is narrow. The narrow way is the way that we leads to what? To life. And he talks about few who find it. So this is really interesting. I think a lot of people are going to be surprised at the last days when they pass away, they wind up at the white throne judgment. They're going to be surprised that their way did not lead to life. So Jesus Christ talks about this. And listen what else he says here in Matthew 7:24. Now this is sweet, lovable, gentle Jesus saying this. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And look what sweet, loving Jesus is going to say to them. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. So there's this myth that is taught in our modern society, especially our American society, that Jesus is just accepting of every single thing and every belief, and he's just all accepting of everything, and all these ways are the right way. But when you read scripture, it's completely opposite of what the world's teaching. He's saying there's the narrow way. Many people are going to go to the way of destruction, and few find the narrow way. So Matthew 7:13 does tend to shock people. It gets them thinking more correctly, I would say. And I think it's good to ask ourselves, are we listening to what Jesus Christ says, and are we taking the narrow way? And of course, Jesus said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Now let's go to Matthew 7:24. Again, sweet, gentle, loving Jesus. Look at the bold that he says here. He says, therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And then the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. Now he has some words for people that chose to reject Jesus Christ. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like and very judgmental here, the phrases, and I say that tongue in cheek. Notice how Jesus is very politically incorrect, which is why I love him so. Jesus says, but everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. Now let's go to Matthew 8:13. Now, when we go to Matthew 8:13 here, there's a centurion, a soldier, that comes to Jesus Christ, and one of his servants is ill, and he comes to Jesus Christ and he asks if Jesus can help. And the centurion has so much confidence in Jesus Christ. He says, just say the word and I'll tell my centurion. I mean, the centurion says to Jesus, I should say, I'll tell my servant, you know, he needs to get well. You know, basically Jesus said, you're going to get well, you're going to get well. Look what the centurion says. He said, Jesus says, I will come out and heal him. But the centurion says, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. And he goes on to tell Jesus that he also is a man under authority, having soldiers under him. And as I say to this one, go, and he goes, and another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. So Jesus is impressed with the confidence that this centurion has in Jesus Christ. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. Now, as you go down in the passage here and you start reading this, they're talking to Jesus, and Jesus sees these great multitudes. And he says something here which is really shocking, right here where it says the cost of discipleship. It says, and when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave a command to depart to the other side. Then a certain scribe came and said to him, Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go. So this part's kind of sad here. Look what Jesus says. He says, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man, he's referring to himself, has nowhere to lay his head. And he's basically telling this scribe, look, you know, you need to count the cost of being my disciple. Because Jesus was going from place to place preaching and healing, and just multitudes would follow him where he would barely have any time to rest. Then here's the shocking part of this passage here. Then another of his disciples said to him, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. Now, what he's talking about is evidently this disciple here. His father was ill, the disciple's father, and he's telling Jesus, look, once my dad passes away, then I'll come follow you. But evidently, the father of the disciple wasn't really a follower of Jesus Christ. So look what Jesus says here. He says, follow me and let the dead bury their own dead. And so Jesus is referring to this person that's alive physically, maybe dead spiritually, of course. He says, let the dead bury their own dead. It's like Jesus is saying, hey, look, get your priorities straight, follow me, and let the dead bury their own dead. Now, check out Matthew 9. You know, before we talk about Matthew 9, it's interesting that if the words of Jesus Christ are true, and I believe them to be true, remember what he talked about, the narrow path, then that means pagans are on the wrong path. Atheists are on the wrong path. Muslims are on the wrong path. Jesus said, he is the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except through him. And he's saying, broad is the road that leads to destruction. And what I'm saying here is, if what Jesus said is true, then all these people that I just named in all those groups, they're on the wrong path. And we would all agree that they all can't be on the right path, because all their teachings, all their doctrines, all their worldview contradict each other. It can't all lead to the same path if they're all contradictory. So here Jesus talks about his authority to forgive sins. Now, you don't get that through atheism. You don't get that through Hinduism. You don't get that through Islam. And when you look at the worldviews of the world and you look at all these different religions, the only solution that I see for mankind is Jesus Christ. This is where we get forgiveness of sins. You don't get that anywhere else except through Jesus Christ. So it seems to me that it makes more rational sense to go with where the proof and evidence is, which is Jesus Christ. So notice this. It says, so Jesus got into a boat, crossed over, and came to his own city. Then behold, they brought him a paralytic lying on a bed. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, be of cheer. But check out what Jesus says here. He says, your sins are forgiven you. It's interesting that he would address the sins of this man. And at once, immediately the scribes start murmuring among themselves, saying that this guy just blasphemed. They're calling Jesus a blasphemer. But Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, "Why do you think evil in your hearts? For which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven you, or to say arise and walk?" So he makes a good point. He's saying, what is easier, to forgive someone's sins or to say the words arise and walk, right? So Jesus just finished saying, get this, guys, son, be of good cheer, your sins are forgiven you, right? He just finished saying those words, and anyone could say those words. You could say them, I could say them. But look what Jesus says in this next sentence. He says, but that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He's saying, look, I'm going to show you proof and evidence that I have the power to forgive sins. He then said to the paralytic, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. And he arose and departed to his house. Now, when the multitude saw it, they marveled and glorified God who had given such power to men. Let us now go to Matthew 10:32. Again, this is one of those passages here in Matthew 10:32. Sweet, loving, gentle Jesus. Look what he says here. With Jesus Christ, it is black and white. There's no gray area. And this is something where if someone wants to say that they're like not against Jesus Christ, but let's say you're a pagan or you're an atheist or you're a Muslim, you might want to rethink your thinking here. Have an open mind. Check this out. Look what Jesus says about people that aren't really Christians, but they're not hostile, let's say, to Jesus Christ. And I have atheist friends that they're not hostile to Jesus Christ. I have Muslim friends that are not hostile to Jesus Christ, but they will not confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, but they think that they can sort of have their cake and eat it too and not be for Jesus Christ, but they're not against him. But look what Jesus Christ says. He says, therefore, whoever confesses me before men, him I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. So everyone likes that part, right? But there's also a price to pay for rejecting Jesus Christ. He says, but whoever denies me before men, him I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Let us now go to Matthew 16:13. Now, when we go to Matthew 16:13, what we see here is Jesus is talking with his disciples, and I imagine them sitting there in a circle, and he's basically going around the room asking them questions. And Jesus goes into the region of Caesarea Philippi, and he asks his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. So notice how Jesus has like a two-fold question here. He first asks them what everyone else thinks, and then he gets personal with them, and he's like, well, who do you say that I am? Which, of course, is a question that every single person, you know, in history has had to ask, has been asked this question, I should say, and has had to answer this question, who do we say that Jesus Christ is? So now notice this. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? And Peter is the first to pipe up here, and he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, and notice Jesus doesn't deny it. He compliments him. He says, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Now, it's interesting that he asks the disciples first who people are saying he is, and then he asks, who do you say that I am? So what's your opinion? Who do you say that Jesus Christ really is?